Canberra politics are about to get even more tense. Julia Gillard has called a special meeting of caucus tomorrow to crash through or crash with her latest plan to ship boat people overseas. And on Tuesday, she introduces her controversial carbon dioxide tax to Parliament. Joining me are former Treasurer Peter Costello and Michael Costa, former New South Wales Labor Treasurer. Michael, is a crash through or crash tomorrow?
I think it's going to be crash in the medium term. I think that the carbon tax, or the carbon dioxide tax to be more accurate, it will be her Achilles, political Achilles heel, both in terms of the problems within the caucus and also more broadly in the community. So for Julia Gillard, she'll probably get a victory in terms of getting the legislation through.
This is on boat people? Or on carbon dioxide tax?
Carbon dioxide tax.
That's going to be your Achilles heel, not boat people.
I think the boat people issue with the current position that Tony Abbott's taken, I think she'll be able to neutralise that issue. The reality is that I think that last week was a very decisive week in terms of Labor positioning Tony Abbott on the issue, and whatever comes up, he's going to have partial responsibility, rightly or wrongly. I think tactically they were smart last week.
So how's it going to crash for her on carbon dioxide tax?
Because the issue will remain. It'll remain an underlying issue with confusion, with public uncertainty and cost of living concerns. And it will remain all the way through to next May, March, when we have the crucial vote on the poker machine tax that Andrew Wilkie won.
Well, this is the thing, Peter, that I don't understand. Labor hasn't got into its mind that Andrew Wilkie is threatening to pull the pin on this government if it doesn't agree to the pokey reforms that he wants and it can't deliver, which means an election probably in June.
I work on the proposition that the most likely this government will last for one more year. There's a possibility the outside two. That's if Wilkie doesn't pull the pin. Now, what's really wrong with legislating the carbon tax now, of course, is that if that gets in and there is an election and the coalition comes to power, you'll never get it out again in the Senate. This is what people haven't figured out, that Labor and the Greens will still have a blocking majority in the Senate, so that Gillard will not just introduce the tax, which she said she wouldn't, but she'll leave it as a legacy for any incoming government. That's first point. The second point is, I think that the Labor Party, however, has thought its strategy very badly. They think to themselves, oh, the difficulty's getting the tax in. They say, look at the GST. Once the GST was in, people got used to it. They stopped complaining. Let me tell you something. Getting the GST through the Parliament was hard, but it wasn't the hardest part. The hardest part was actually implementing it 12 months later. And it was when people started paying it, about a year after it had been introduced, that the pain really hit the hip pocket nerve. And I'd say to those backbenchers in Labor who are being fed this line, oh, look, once it's in, all your problems will be over. Don't think that for a moment. That's when they really start.
But, Michael, I don't even believe that Julia Gillard will get to test this theory that when people live the tax, they'll forgive Labor. Because if we're right, and there's an election before the tax gets implemented in July next year, the next election will be a referendum on the tax they haven't yet got. It'll be the biggest scare campaign. It'll be Liberals saying, this is your last chance to vote against the tax.
Well, it'll be more than that. It'll also be a referendum on the Green-Labor alliance, which is the fundamental disastrous political decision that she's made. You can trace everything back to that disastrous alliance. So, you know, the carbon tax will certainly be a subset of that, but I think it'll be the whole mismanagement of the, you know, the last 2 years of government. And again, you know, if you look at where Gillard is at the moment, her scope for manoeuvrability is really limited.
Is it time, Peter, for the Liberals to start demanding an inquiry into the laws regarding how union leaders spend union members' funds? We're talking about the claims about Craig Thompson, the backbencher, using credit card, union credit card, to pay for prostitutes, withdraw $100,000. Claims against Bill Ludwig, which aren't denied, that he used union members' money for a private legal battle, $45,000. Claims about Michael Williamson, the vice president of Labor, about his use of money. What's going on?
Well, you'd have to say that there are a lot of claims about fraud and corruption in the union movement. There always have been. And you think to yourself, if these were companies, or if these were schools, or if these were some kind of public institution, that the police investigation would be far more robust than it ever seems to be in relation to union affairs. And I just have a feeling that in Australia we've allowed this belief to occur that somehow unions should be treated in a privileged way. They're part of the political apparatus. We shouldn't expect of them the same kinds of standards that we do of other public institutions. And I think that this has allowed the corruption to go unchecked. I think that the government has connived in this in certain ways. Let me give you an example. We know about criminality on building sites. Standover, extortion, and all the rest of it. This government is the government that is disbanding the Building Construction Commission, which was there to actually police it. And so you look at all of this and you say to yourself, well, how does this occur? I think there is a frightened attitude from the police at enforcing the laws in unions in the same way as other public institutions.
And there's also a frightened media in reporting things Julia Gillard's past relationship.
Let me defend the police, being a former police minister as well. Police can only operate on the law. In most of these cases, leaving around the morality of misusing members' funds, and it's a complete misuse, and one of the problems with Julia Gillard's position is that she hasn't even come out decisively on the morality issue. You know, is this the right thing to do with union funds? The problem is that under current regulations, as long as the Finance Committee signs off on the expenditure, the authorising bodies, there hasn't been a fraudulent act. And this is what came out of the New South Wales investigation.
But whether that's right or wrong,
The reality is that you need to be careful on these issues. And I take some of these issues with a grain of salt too, because some of the reporting is from people that in the past have been wrong.
All right. Look, I don't know that the public's going to buy it. I think that's the ultimate thing.
I don't think it's right.
I want to move. The biggest political impact, I think, in people's consciousness in the past week has been what a million people saw on TV this week, which was At Home with Julia on the ABC. Can I just show you a bit of it? Because I think this might actually work in her favour.
Bill Shorten.
What? What's he doing here?
No, that's what we call our little terrier. Cos you're always at mummy's heels, aren't you? Yes, ratbag.
Is this going to make Julia seem a more sympathetic figure to a million watching people?
I thought there was some good casting. I thought the actress that played Julia was well cast, and I thought that the casting of Shorten was brilliant. You know, the little terrier that's the family pet. And I actually saw that Bill came out and he said that he quite liked being portrayed that way, you know, which I thought was strange, you know. Any role to get me into the lodge, I thought, for Bill. You know, I had to turn it off. I couldn't bear it because, Andrew, I mean, some of it was funny, but, you know, it did raise a whole lot of questions that we don't really want to think about.
Well, look, I turned it off too. I didn't think it was that funny. And in fact, if you look at it, the satire that's going on in Canberra is actually probably better satire. They're running the plays like, you know, a Marx Brothers movie where it's some sort of Central European fictional community and, you know, that Gillard's in charge of. I just thought it wasn't that funny.
I thought it was funny, and I thought what a lot of people will see is the poor woman having to deal with the independents, and I thought they got that one bit beautifully.
I think they got oak shot beautifully. I thought
it was too tragic to be funny. It was a bit like Yes Minister. I never thought that was a comedy. I actually thought that
it's
that was a serious current affairs show.
Yeah, well, you're on the unity ticket with Therese Rain, who thought it was all a bit rough anyway.
Let me say this. I mean, a lot of other people have had satires made about them.
Including me, so I don't think
this is new news, by the way. The difference is it's on the ABC.
Gentlemen, this show needs to be an hour to accommodate such talents. Michael Costa, Peter Costello, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.